So at this time, I would like to invite those of you who are, or not invite you, but welcome the people who are joining us online this morning. It is a delight to have you share with us in this way. We're so thankful for technology that provides us this opportunity to connect like this. We're thankful for those in our congregation who know how to do this kind of thing. So we just say welcome, and we pray you would really sense through the screen the presence of Jesus. The presence of Jesus right in your living room or wherever you're sitting this morning. May you receive the fullness of all that God has for you today. So before we have our scripture reading, I recently finished reading through the book of Acts again, and I was taken aback in a fresh way at how much emphasis and how many verses there were about the name of Jesus and the power in the name of Jesus. And a number of weeks ago, a number of months ago now, I came across a song that's called Something About That Name. And I really wanted to begin this portion of our worship service with listening to this song and really reflecting on the name of Jesus and what it means to each and every one of us. So I just invite you to relax, sit back, and enjoy this song for a few minutes. And then Nori will come up and give the scriptures for us.
Over faith. something about that name. And we hear about his name and we get to know him and his word. I'll be reading from three places this morning in the Bible. The beginning text we'll be reading from will be from Psalm 102. The following will be from Malachi 3. And then the third will be from the letter of James. Psalm 102. I want to read this slowly this morning. This is the prayer of an afflicted person when he's faint and pours out his heart to God. And so he plunges the depth of human experience, but then we hear about the unchangeableness of God. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Let my cry for help come to you. Do not hide your face from me when I am in distress. Turn your ear to me when I call. Answer me quickly. For my days vanish like smoke. My bones burn like glowing embers. My heart is blighted and withered like grass. I forget to eat my food. Because of my loud groaning, I'm reduced to skin and bones. I'm like a desert owl, like an owl among the ruins. I lie awake. I become like a blind bird alone on a roof. All day long, my enemies taunt me. Those who rail against me use my name as a curse. For I eat ashes as my food and mingle my drink with tears because of your great wrath, for you have taken me up and thrown me aside. My days are like the evening shadow. I wither away like grass. But you, O Lord, sit enthroned forever. Your renown endures through all generations. You will arise and have compassion on Zion, for it is time to show favor to her. The appointed time has come. For her stones are dear to your servants. Her very dust moves them to pity. The nations will fear the name of the Lord. All the kings of the earth will revere your glory. For the Lord will rebuild Zion and appear in his glory. He will respond to the prayer of the destitute. He will not despise their plea. Let this be written for a future generation, that a people not yet created may praise the Lord. The Lord looked down from his sanctuary on high. From heaven he viewed the earth, to hear the groans of the prisoners and release those condemned to death. So the name of the Lord will be declared in Zion and his praise in Jerusalem when the peoples and the kingdoms assemble to worship the Lord. In the course of my life, he broke my strength. He cut short my days. So I said, do not take me away, O my God, in the midst of my days. Your years go on through all generations. In the beginning, you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like clothing, you will change them, and they will be changed. But you remain the same, and your years will never end. The children of your servants will live in your presence. Their descendants will be established before you. Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament. Malachi 3, beginning at verse 6, we'll read verses 6 and 7. Malachi 3, 6 and 7. Malachi the prophet, God speaks through Malachi, and the book is written in a question and answer format. And so the people are complaining against God, thinking God wasn't good. And so God responds and says, how haven't I been good? And so there, the book continues on in a question and answer format, very unique in the Old Testament. And we pick it up in verse 6 of chapter 3. I, the Lord, do not change, so you, O descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I'll return to you, says the Lord Almighty. Now into the letter of James, into the New Testament. Past the book of Hebrews, James chapter 1, we'll begin in verse 13 and read down through verse 18. James 1:13, blessed is the The man or woman who perseveres in her trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he, by his own evil desire, he is dragged away and enticed. Then after desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is full grown, it gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. That's the Lord's word this morning.
When I was a little girl, I had the privilege of being a part of a family that went to Bible college. So my dad went to Bible college when I was about 8 years old, and I loved it. I was a social butterfly. I loved hanging out with these older, they were teenagers, you know, 18 to 20 young adults, 18 to 21 years, and they would always have these like socials where we'd go to this upper building, the upper level of a building, and they'd have these songs that we would just sing, and they were, I mean, this was back in the 80s, right? So, I mean, they were just great songs, and so I love that some of these little choruses are in our hymn book. And so this morning we're going to sing a couple of those, and the first one is, and I'm sure you'll know it, is His Name is Wonderful. So I would invite you to stand with me and let's declare that together, how wonderful the name of Jesus is. Jesus is more beautiful than any nature we're going to see outside. And I can hardly wait for the day that we get to see him face to face. Would you sing with me?
There is Lord Jesus, who
invite you to stand. We're going to sing All Hail King Jesus. Let's declare it this morning, friends. All Hail King Jesus. And we will actually sing it three times through. It's a very short little chorus. Let's sing together. Sing this to you face to face. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
That was really special. That was moving. As we were singing, I couldn't help but feel like we have a gift we hold in our hands, God's Word, that does not change like shadows. It doesn't change and shift like sand dunes, like the blowing of the wind. And when we gather here, these are sacred moments. It may take us a little bit when we gather here on a Sunday morning to begin to feel that. We might have a lot of clutter in our hearts. Some things may have gone on during the week. We might be going through a season of testing or difficulties. It might take us a bit on a Sunday morning. We might not walk through these doors and right away go, boom, this is so sacred, because we carry the world with us. We carry stuff in our hearts. But our prayer is that for all of us, as we've come in here this morning, for those listening online, that at some point in time this morning, you will begin to feel, okay, what we're doing has eternal implications. Eternal implications. those little buttons sometimes look like they're on, but there's a little mute button that sometimes tricks me. So Lord, we thank you that we can be here this morning. We thank you that we can begin to put away some of the clutter of our week. We would ask, Lord, that you would, in your grace and your mercy, and in your gentleness, come and calm our hearts. Give us peace in our hearts. Give us this strong sense that you can be trusted with our lives. Give us this sense, this strong sense that no matter what goes on in our world, in our own lives, what we experience with our senses, there's someone who is unchanging. That your word doesn't change. Take away whatever barriers might be in our hearts this morning to hear and receive. Even this last hiccup with the sound, Lord, we ask you just push that away. Push that away. There was something about that in that moment. And we're asking you that you would just take that and push that away. In Jesus' name. We've been working through the book of James, the letter of James, and it's titled Our Best Foot because I believe strongly that the time has come in a unique way, not like ever before, but in a unique way right now for the Church of Jesus Christ to put our best foot forward in our society. There are so many things going on that are polarizing us as believers. They're polarizing the church in different ways, and There's just a lot of things going, and our world is watching very closely. It's time for the Church of Jesus Christ to walk in the way of wisdom. And the book of James, the letter of James, has been called the New Testament book of Proverbs. It's a New Testament book of wisdom. And so this is a time, it's a crucial time for the Church of Jesus Christ, for believers all over, to walk in a way of wisdom. And we talked a few weeks ago, that doesn't mean we talk like Yoda, we talk like Obi-Wan Kenobi, it doesn't mean the worldly pictures of wisdom. It means what we say needs to be modeled with our life. It's words and actions. We're going to be talking about that in a few weeks. So it's not so much. It does include, the book of Proverbs does, it's pearls of wisdom, little sentences that are world-changing and life-changing sentences to know. But it's not just that. James comes along and says, hey, it's that, but it's also that connected to a life connected to the way of Jesus. So we're talking about that. Last week we talked about how sin progresses in life, in the human heart. And we talked about the lures, the shininess of lures and what it's like. The imagery comes from the world of fishing. And how desire starts with desire. And when desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. When sin is nurtured and trained and full grown, it brings forth death. So desire, when we give attraction and a plan, gives birth to sin. Sin wants to grow. It wants to have impact in our lives. It wants to grow and change us. It wants to be trained. And when we give it training and nurture it, eventually it gives birth and it brings forth death, spiritual death, and sometimes even physical death. This morning, we're going to continue on with that. James is still talking about that. He's still talking. And he's saying, I want to continue talking about this. We're not going to leave this. A well-known pastor in a North American church recounts a personal story where he became disillusioned with God. Discouraged in his life work, and he was ready to quit and move on. His pastor felt called by God to preach, actually when he was a teenager. He was encouraged by many when he was in his teen years and actually preached his first message from the book of Jonah. He goes back and he says, I can't believe people actually listened to that message. People were very gracious and encouraging. He was in his 20s, and it was in the 60s when he went to college. He was involved with various ministry organizations on campus at college, enjoyed quite a bit of ministry success, visible fruit bearing in what he was doing as he lived his life for God. Then he went to seminary. During that time, he can recall actually very few weeks when there was at least one person that did not respond. They were talking every week now. One person that at least did not respond positively to the message of the gospel. That was the decade of the 60s and a bit in the 70s. It was that time when he married the love of his life, his ministry-minded, outgoing wife, Barbara. Went to seminary, began to study theology, he loved every minute of it, and developed lifelong friendships while in seminary, and it was just all a sign to him that there were things that were going to happen to him and his wife on the horizon that were good things, fruitful things. They were coming, he could see them and feel them. When the 70s came, he felt like it was time to begin pastoral ministry and preaching, so with the full and enthusiastic support of their home church, they began a spin-off church, a church plant. Expectations were great. They were running high. They prayed long and hard. They did everything scientifically with aerial photographs, demographic studies, ethnographic surveys, you name it. They did it. They worked hard. Everyone told them it would not be long until their new daughter church would outsize the mother church, but actually that's not how it went at all. After considerable time and immense effort, they actually had fewer attenders than in the initial months. The church actually looked like it was shrinking. He began to feel as though his bright prospects were melting around him, and in his words, and I quote him, I descended into the deepest, darkest depression of my life. And then one hot, late summer night in 1975, he experienced what he called a midnight of the soul, or a dark night of the soul, and he poured out all his dark, pent-up thoughts of disillusionment and discouragement to his wife. And he felt like in that moment he reached bottom. And he voiced to his wife Barbara, who was listening to him, feeling with him. He said to her, God has called me to do something he hasn't given me the gifts to accomplish. Therefore, God is not good. He felt as though he was, as he describes, the butt of a cruel joke. And he wanted to quit. In desperation, he said to his wife, what am I to do? He said, as long as I live, I'll never forget her kind and confident response. She said to him, I don't know what you're going to do, but for now, for tonight, hang on to my faith, because I believe. I believe God is good. I believe he loves us and is going to work through this experience. So hang on to my faith. I have enough for both of us. And so he recalls, and with that, being the fearless gallant man that I am, I went off to bed. That dark night of discouragement marked the beginning of a process through which they both began to think through what life with God and what God had for them as a pastoral ministry couple. And that story became chronicled in a book they co-wrote together called Liberating Ministry from the Success Syndrome. It's a story from the world of pastoral ministry. I readily understand that, but I can't tell you how many times I've listened to people share stories like that. Just change the landscape a little bit, change the vocation, change the story a little bit. The thread, the narrative is the same. Great expectations, disappointments, and then an idea of how what God is like comes out of that.
Yeah.
But I venture to say that most of us, if not all of us, have had similar thoughts to varying degrees like that. We read from the psalmist. We read from the psalms often. The psalm writers were brutally honest. Let's face it, friends, we sometimes have the tendency to think evil or negatively or badly, maybe not evil, but negatively or badly sometimes, to varying degrees, about God when tragedy comes. Challenging trials come to us or to those we love, like when we perhaps have lost our job or have undergone a divorce or a separation or feel like we face one mountain after another and we just never see the light of day in these tough times we're going through or that we face, or as we look around us and we observe it in our world and we make conclusions about how God is based on what we see in our world as a whole. Or in culture, human life, moments of brutal honesty, moments that even though they're profoundly honest, they may be blasphemous to God. But God in his grace and his power strives with us and journeys with us in our honesty when we express it to him. He did with the songwriters. and the biblical writers. Very similar to the honest prayers recorded in what is called the prayer book of the Bible, the book of Psalms. They happen. God hears us. He remembers that we are dust. But here's the thing, friends. It's one thing to be deeply open with God about how we feel victimized, or we feel treated unfairly, or by Him, perhaps. We don't hear a response. We don't feel anything with our senses from Him. And God is supposed to speak to us. We're supposed to journey with Him. He's supposed to be intimate. It's supposed to be a friendship and a relationship, but many times we don't feel, hear, or sense that He's with us. And so after a period of time, we draw conclusions. That's human life. That's a human tendency to do that. And so the psalm writers are brutally honest, but they never let those moments when they're in their deepest place become a way of life, become a way of thinking throughout the course of their life. They're experiencing deep challenges. They're in a pit. They express that to God, but the psalm almost always leads us to a place, not where the problem is solved, but where their thinking comes back to the unchangeableness and the trustworthy and the goodness of God. So, something happens when we begin to let a certain way of thinking lodge itself into our mind and heart. Once they begin to settle into our thinking over time, they begin to neutralize and even destroy the health and vitality of our spiritual life. Friends, I want to say this compassionately, sensitively, as a shepherd, a true shepherd, but clearly with conviction, that it is impossible to walk with God in a healthy way. That doesn't mean He abandons us, but to walk with God in a healthy way over time if we are always questioning His goodness at every turn in the road. Mm-hmm. It just is. Mm-hmm. Just like you can't have a healthy marital relationship, a healthy friendship with anyone when you're always suspicious of them. If something happens in an email where perhaps information isn't given, or a mistake is made, and there's suspicion at every turn, that relationship doesn't grow. That doesn't mean it's over. It just doesn't grow. It doesn't ever get a chance to become healthy and strong. Communication breaks down. Last week, if you were with us, we looked at how the scripture writer James tells us how sin begins and grows. In those verses, when we read that, and I will just read them again to refresh our memory. Verse 13, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desire, is dragged away and enticed. Then after evil desire is conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Now, when we hear that, we have a tendency to think of the big sins. Jesus talks in Mark 7, verse 4, things that come out of the human heart. Theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness, and on it goes, a list of vices. Not conclusive, not all conclusive, but a big list that comes out of the human heart. These things come out of, what comes out of a heart is what defiles a person, not what goes in. Referring to food controversies, and he said, put the food controversy aside. Food doesn't defile you anymore. What goes on in here defiles you. And what comes out is this. And he gives a list. And so we naturally think when John James said that, so when desire, this is how sin grows and develops. So here's desire. Desire is there in the human heart. It's there. It's neither good nor bad. Ultimately, we could say it's good before it becomes bad, but desire is there. And then a challenge confronts us, and we're tempted to respond to that challenge in a good way and be tested by it, or in a negative way, be tempted by it. If we go down the road and respond to it in temptation, then desire gives birth to sin and receives traction and a plan, like I mentioned before. We tend to think and read into James that he's talking directly about those big sins that I just mentioned that Jesus talks about and the other biblical writers such as the Apostle Paul. But here's the thing. I don't think that was in James's. I think it's perfectly and appropriate and applicable to apply those sins to what James is saying. That sin grows. Those sins grow when desires conceive. Absolutely. But I think in James' front view, he's thinking about something else. So James, while he's describing the general way that sin progresses in life, was actually referring to some other things, I believe, that were directly applicable to the scattered, oppressed, and challenged New Testament church. And a key one for believers in that day and that time was blaming God for the challenges they faced. So James says, follow that thinking through time, blaming God and accusing him of wrongdoing and evil. And if you do that, that way of thinking, once it's conceived and is given a plan, that way of thinking is allowed to mature and gain traction and become skilled in one's thinking. That way of thinking then over a course of life brings forth spiritual death. Mm-hmm. This way of thinking is a common objection to those outside Jesus Christ. When you talk with the people outside the faith, which I have so many times journeyed with people outside the faith in construction and the trades and in friendships. That way of thinking over the course of life, it's very common to those outside the church. They look at life. They look around and say, hey, look, if God was good, powerful, and loving, then these things just wouldn't happen in our world. We know that that's there. I'm sure the majority of us will have had people say that to us. Those things wouldn't happen. Those things. Consider the late poet and author Stephen Crane, the American poet, who repeated in stanza after stanza in one of his poems, God is cold. Now, Stephen Crane, he was known for being cynical about God. I'll just read a couple of stanzas from his poem. I won't read the whole thing. It's called A Man Adrift on a Slim Spar. A man adrift on a slim spar, a horizon smaller than the rim of a bottle. Tented waves rearing, lashing dark points near the wine of froth and circles. God is cold. The incessant rage and swing of the sea, the growl after growl of crest, the sinking screen seething endless, the upheaval half completed. God is cold. And on he goes. I won't read the whole thing. It's not meant to give attention to too much of that this morning, but it's there. The perspective. I think Stephen Crane speaks for many people outside the faith, many people in our world, in our community, that when they look around, they see God is cold. So even times of brutal honesty with God, we need to know that moment is an opportunity to grow stronger in testing, or it can be an opportunity for temptation to receive traction and for sin to be birthed and to grow in our lives. The early Christians had fled persecution in Jerusalem, and they continually experienced ongoing oppression as Christians, at the hands of fellow Jews and Romans. They fled Jerusalem, and then where they settled in the Mediterranean region, they experienced persecution from non-Christ-believing Jews and from Romans. Very difficult time. They had it coming at them from every direction. So the readers of James' letter were in a very similar situation. And so that experience, persecution coming at them in every direction, suspicion, having to watch what they say to people, being ratted out all the time, left them not only saying, God is tempting me, but they began to verbalize the parallel idea that God is not good. So God's tempting me, and because of that, God's also not good. Friends, as a pastor, I've met many people over the years, confessing followers of Jesus who have allowed this way of thinking to shape them. That way of thinking has been allowed to be nurtured. It's been very clear as I've met with people. And I don't say this giving out any personal information or anything inappropriate about what I'm saying here, except as my experience as a pastor, I've had many conversations with people. Many conversations with people in my office or out for coffee or out for a lunch or a breakfast. They tell their story. And it's become clear that this way of thinking has given time to lodge inside of them, to grow, to nurture. That way of thinking has become trained, and it's begun to shape the way they live, the way they shape, the way they think about God, the church, events that happen to them. And it's incredibly difficult, barring a miracle, it is incredibly difficult to take somebody and convince them in that moment that God is actually good, that the what they've been thinking and how they perceive God is actually a lie. Mm-hmm. They've been deceived. That's why James comes right out of the gate in our text this morning, right after talking about this is the way sin grows and develops, and he said, don't be deceived. Yeah. And then he goes on and he talks about the fact that God is good. Every time a curve comes in the road, a loss, a wound, a challenge to them or their family, God hasn't come through. And it's very difficult to love God, to live for him, to walk on Jesus, on his way with him, when we're always questioning his goodness, his faithfulness, and his integrity. So for sure, at least some in the first century Christian community were tempted to think that God is not good, that he doesn't give his wisdom generously to those who trust him, that he does in fact tempt people into sin and harm them, and that he's hard to trust because he's changing. So I just want to encourage you this morning, if that's your story, it's always been the human story. It's a challenge, but it's not a challenge God can't overcome in your life and in the church. But you have to be willing to change. You have got to be willing to let God come in and change the train tracks.
Yeah.
Take the wagon out of those deep tracks and those ruts and set them on brand new ground.
Amen. That's right.
You've got to be willing. If you are not willing, can I say this lovingly and compassionately, but you'll die that way. You'll die in that way of thinking. That doesn't mean that you will not be with God in eternity. But this life lived, you will not experience an intimate relationship like he wants for you, like he wants with you. So James, he can help them sift through these thinking patterns. It's a big opening, and I will be quicker now. But James, he can help them sift through these thinking patterns, now begins to respond to them in verse 16. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. That's why he says what he says. Don't be deceived. Why? It's a command which rings down the centuries to us today. James is really, really direct with the Church of Jesus Christ here. For your soul's sake, brothers and sisters, don't be deceived. Don't bite that shiny lure like I talked about when I was swimming for that lure last Sunday. Swimming for it, and the sun was shining on it, and I was just trying to get down to the bottom of the river, and I was just far away, but I couldn't get it. Don't chase it. Every thought, though it seems to make sense, though it seems to fit the dominant majority worldview, though it seems to help your emotional life or make sense, don't grab onto that way of thinking. Why? Because God isn't like that, regardless of what our human experiences seem to say to us. Verse 17, he said, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. That doesn't mean this is not a spiritual gift verse, though it's not wrong to apply it to that, but that's not exactly what James is talking about. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. We all know that I could stand out in the sun, arms folded, and depending on where the sun was at, my shadow would change. It would start one way, and at one point in time, it would be hard to see it, and then it would change again as the sun, the way it was hitting me, would cause my shadow to move. God's not like that. Since God doesn't send temptation meant to harm us, the implied question is, okay, now, what does God send? He doesn't send temptation to harm us. What does he send? James answers by saying God gives good gifts. As we've already seen in his gift of wisdom that he generously gives to those who ask. He gives good gifts. Yes, he does send testing. That's meant to grow us and strengthen us. But the testing is good. We could have gone to various places in our scripture reading this morning to show that this testing is good for us. God is the Father of lights, which means two things. First, God is, the first is that God is the Father of the universe and that he has power over the heavenly galaxies, their creator. The second is that God is Father and Father of light. Powerful images if we actually meditate on them. Powerful images, if we meditate on them, we'll actually dispel wrong ideas about God. He's a good God, and he is a God of light, not of darkness. As the Apostle John writes, God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. In 1 John 1:5 is recorded. So James further describes God as one who does not change like shifting shadows. God is light, and in him there is no shadow. God is the creator of the lights in the universe. So James is using two astronomical terms to describe the variation in which the heavenly bodies show, the variation in the length of the day and the night, the apparent variation in the course of the sun, the increasing of the different brilliance of different times of the stars and planets waning, and that God is unlike the planets. He's unlike the stars. He's unlike things that change in the universe. Friends, variability, changeableness, is a characteristic of all created things. Variability, changeableness. This means that things shift and change like the stars shift and waver. God is the creator of the things that change. But while God is the creator of this variability in creation, there's no variability and change in God. His constancy is there. He's stable. He's trustworthy.
Amen.
So life is a gift, and God's always good. God doesn't ever send emails that should have been written differently, or text messages that should have been written differently. God does never say the wrong words and have to retract. God never changes. God is always good.
That's right.
Now James says, life's not only a gift, it's an opportunity. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. We know that in the scriptures, destroy life, and wants to use our yielding to temptation over time to do it by giving birth to sin and death in our lives. But sin, death, and Satan never, and I mean never, write the last chapter. They never write the last chapter.
That's right. Amen.
God does. Yeah. God's the one that writes the last chapter. Friends, God also, in a sense, gives birth. Not in the way that we would humanly think, but spiritually he does, and he uses his word to do it in our hearts. James says he chose to give us birth through the word of truth. The one who does not change chose to give us birth through the word of truth. The word of truth is the gospel. And by stating his gospel, it's God's gracious and loving purpose that people should be reborn into new life. The shadows are ended, and the unchanging word of truth has come, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. So friends, life is a joyful opportunity. In the ancient Old Testament world, it was law that all first fruits were sacred to God, and so they were offered in grateful sacrifice to God because they belonged to him. I was reminded this week, someone shared with me a little funny story of a chicken named Henrietta whose egg-laying days were slowing down, and the little stories that God described in two scenes. The first scene shows Henrietta, the chicken, just so happens to overhear its owner tell someone that when Henrietta actually stops laying eggs, they're going to eat her. The next scene shows that the chicken at the till in a grocery store buying eggs. I'm told that this is a Far Side cartoon. And the caption underneath said, and this is why the chicken crossed the road. Friends, thankfully God is good. And while he saves us and reconciles us to himself, he doesn't do so to put us into a generic fruit-bearing farm, to work tirelessly for him and disposes of us when we make a mistake or when we slow down or when we go through a challenge or we become discouraged. He doesn't dispose of us. He doesn't discard us. But he strives with us. His mercies are new absolutely every morning. Do you need to hear that this morning? We all do. His mercies are new every morning, no matter what has happened to you this week, no matter what has gone to happen to you this year. His mercies are new every morning. He wants to strive with you. He wants to strive with us. But we have to want to. We have to want to change with him. We're the ones that change. He expects us to change. He doesn't change, but he expects us to. We're not in some kind of cosmic experiment. We're not the butt of some cruel joke, as some would be tempted to say. The Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus, "For by grace you've been saved through faith. It's not your own doing, it's the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast." It's like a beautiful portrait on full display. This is the goodness of the Father. Look at those words. Just look at those words. Grace, saved, faith, gift. We need to meditate on those words more. We do. Friends, if we take those words out of the Christian vocabulary and out of our holidays, we have no celebration in our Holy Communion. It's a child's tea party. So our experience in this chaotic world is a shadow. It will one day fade, and we'll be in eternity, face to face with the one who doesn't change. But the one who doesn't change walks with us every day. Let's make sure we know and trust the reality. Verse 10, "For we are God's masterpiece," Paul said. "He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago." He's created us for good works. He's created us to shine in the world. He's created us to display his glory in all of life, to enjoy him. Not because he needs it. Not because he has a challenging ego. And not because he has a glass ego. Not because he's insecure. But when we enjoy him, we display his glory. And that, for God, is infinitely good. Friends, I feel like it's really important for me to say this. I really feel like it's important for me to say two things. First is this, as we look to conclude. If you're going through challenges, or you have gone through challenges, and you have wrestled, is God good? Is he with me? And so on. If that narrative described here this morning is something you've wrestled with, and I know we have to some degree, all of us in life, but recently for you, if it's really brought you down, I don't want you to feel like I'm coming down hard on you. We don't work in guilt in the church. We open the word and we let it breathe.
Amen. Yeah.
So there's no hammer here this morning, there's no guilt. But would you just receive the word this morning? Breathe it in. I don't mean in a new age way, but breathe it in literally. Take it in. Listen to it. Let it become implanted in your heart in a new and a fresh way this morning. Because he's good. One day we'll look back and we'll go, "Wow, you were so good." But he wants us to feel that way now. He wants the penny to drop now. Maybe you need that in a special way this morning. That's the first thing. The second thing is this. If you're a young parent and you're listening, if you listen to this and you're a young mom or a young parent, young dad, you listen to this later on, you're a grandparent and you've got grandkids, can I say this? It is absolutely crucial that you begin, as you're allowed, grandparents, as you're allowed, as is appropriate, as you work with your own kids, that you begin to teach your grandkids and your kids, even as adults, that God does not work according to the human code of fairness. Friends, if you raise your kids from the time they're little and you teach them that the code of life is all about fairness, God is not going to work. God does not operate according to the code of humanity. There are times when God will feel incredibly trustworthy to you in your experience. There are times when he will feel unfair. God does not do things to be fair. Even the concept of fairness, he doesn't operate according to that. God is always good.
Yes.
Always good. This is why sometimes it's so hard to trust him.
Mm-hmm.
Because we want him to operate according to the code. God, I want you to relate to me according to the code of fairness. And if you don't, we're going to have a hard time. And God responds and says, I'm not fair, but I'm good. I'm always good and I don't change. I'm good, I'm loving, and I don't change. I will strive with you. I will journey with you. It's like when we say that God is not safe, but he's good.
Yeah.
We have an idea of safety. That's a human code. But God says, according to that code, sometimes I may not feel safe because I'm going to test you. I'm going to lead you into waters of testing. That doesn't feel safe. So according to the human code that you want from me, sometimes I'm not going to feel safe. I won't feel trustworthy and I won't feel fair, but I am always, always, always good.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And can I say this? If we're not in this book, we will always be tempted to think in the way of the world, to think in those ways. There's a way. There's a way that seems right to a man, but it leads to death. We will naturally want to think in that way. The human code. But God is always good. Always, always good. So Lord, I thank you for your word. I pray that we would all take in this, breathe it in. Let it go down into our deepest parts. Because your word is living and active. And Lord, you want your word to shape us. You want it to produce life. You want us to make us salty in how we respond to our world. I think of all the things, the divisive things, the aggressive things, the angst and frustration and questioning that's going on in our society right now. I pray that you would help us to walk in the way of wisdom. That we would be loving in how we communicate. That we would say to you, Lord, I am willing to change. I am willing to change the way I think. I'm willing to change the way I think about what happened long ago to that point in time in my life. I'm willing to let that way of thinking go. I want to follow you. Come, continue to strive with me and journey with me and help me. Help me believe you. Help me to trust you. That you're good no matter what. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Friends, I really believe that was, well, I believe every Sunday is anointed, but I believe that was an especially anointed message this morning. And I feel compelled to share with you that I am so grateful that I grew up in a home in which my parents both were people of the Word. And the word became very dear to my heart as a young teenager. And now, having read through it, and I only say this because it's made all the difference in my life. Having read the Bible now through 30, 40 times, cover to cover, that has shaped me so deeply. So that when my children were younger, many years ago, and early in our marriage, God required a lot of really difficult things from me. Really difficult. And I remember one day sitting on the couch and my oldest boy walking in, and I was sobbing. I was just bawling uncontrollably because of what God was requiring of me. And I looked at him and I said, Nori Jr., no matter what God requires of you, don't ever doubt that he is a good God. This is hard. This is painful. But I don't doubt the goodness of God even in this. So even as Nori was preaching this morning, my heart swelled with such gratitude to God that now 53 years into the journey, I hear him preach a message like this, and it is foreign. The wagon tracks are in deep of knowing God is so good that I can't imagine not. And so I share that to you as a testimony to the amazing grace and faithfulness of God in my life, of walking with Him and knowing He is so good, and He's required so much along the way. It's not been easy, but with His help and by His grace, I can say to you and sing with you, God, you're so good. And may He give you the grace to do the same, no matter what He requires of you or has required of you.
Amen.
I invite you to stand and let's sing to our good God how good He is.
That welcomes me, the kindness.
want to take one, just a brief moment. Brief moment. I would like us to, just like in your own heart and mind, this is not manipulation, not trying to manipulate you or pressure you to think or do anything. In your own mind, in your own heart this morning, maybe grab hold of or give that disappointment or that wound, that part of an experience that still affects you, still cries out or whispers in your heart, that needs a touch from God. I feel like this is a very sacred moment right here. Church of Jesus Christ needs to believe that he's good. But life is hard. Life is really hard. I don't speak to those outside the faith in any way that the way they're thinking is crazy. It's natural. It's the natural way to think as a human being. If people outside the faith thought any differently, it would be an absolute miracle. But people inside the church, Satan wants you to think that way. He wants us to think of a time where we were betrayed, a time where we experienced profound loss, or we were wounded, and hold on to that and think a way about God that isn't the way he is. He's good. So friends, as we hold on to that, we're going to ask God to speak to that as we give it to him. Mm-hmm. And in your own mind, in your own heart, as I give us, and I give us, pray for it, us with this benediction this morning from the letter of Jude, from the writer Jude. Imagine yourself giving this to God. Mm-hmm. Scripture tells us to take in the word, to meditate on the word, metaphorically to eat the word. That's a common metaphor. So take it in, receive it to him this morning. To him who was able to keep us from stumbling over that way of thinking. To him who was able to keep us from stumbling and to present us blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the glory, majesty, dominion, and authority, before all time and now and forever, mm-hmm. He will always be good. He's good now, and he will be good this week, no matter what happens.
Amen.
God bless you all.
Amen.
Thanks for coming.
Amen. Amen.